electricity cables would give their cables a touch and you could be electrocuted.
Okay, since the cables run through body runners, and then they just be there running around the properties.
When they did catch
the lead, fantastic, quite even. Brilliant. They even tried wrapping it in cloth, they wrapped up in wood, they wrapped up in it. Basically anything they thought might stop the electricity from being inadvertently touching them.
And earthing, the ability to make a faulty circuit safe by redirecting it to the earth, simply did.
There's no waste, there's nothing at all. So if you had a small child, they could just be in touch with these things. Absolutely lethal.
Lethal or not, kept inventing and found the new power source could be used for all sorts of domestic appliances. We see in the Electric House, the centrepiece of the 1908 Manchester Electrical Exhibition, the Tomorrow's World. And on display were all the must-have items for the ideal Edwardian home. One exciting postcard about their visit.
I went to an electrical exhibition last week and spent a very enjoyable afternoon. The kettle's boiling on the grill, all on a clean table without a speck of dust.
What sort of items are available? A whole range of things that we find at commonplace in our homes today, but also a whole other range of things which maybe we're not so familiar with.
All sorts of weird and wonderful, some of which have not been seen before or since, as suppliers try to generate a demand for electricity beyond the electric.
What's this? That's actually an early electric curling tong, and you just put your curling tong in there to heat up.
And this must have been quite a first time. Up until now, irons had been heated on coal stoves.
In many ways, I guess that was hard to break through, and people probably wouldn't respond on in the early days.
A look at the magazines and papers of the time. A mental lack of understanding about how to use electricity safely, even by some manufacturers.
In the evening time of 1908, they recommended the use of an electric table cloth, a device which it says up to date.
Thankfully, despite the marketing, this electrical wonder did not catch on. But they didn't have the infrastructure we have today, and here lay the problem.
They used a lot of stuff to run all sorts of people.
Through the cable and sat melting the cable.
how quickly overloading can cause a fire, Martin applies a battery to wire wall. The battery is tipped with a wire, mirroring what might have happened in the Edwardian home when extra appliances were added to the electric light socket. This overloading of one circuit is what caused fires in Edwardian homes.
It wasn't safety regulated in the way ours is now. There were no circuit breakers or any of that safety equipment that we now rely on.
Modern fuse boxes protect homes from this. As soon as the system becomes overloaded, it cuts out. Then the electricity would keep flowing. Although the Institution of Electrical Engineers issued a decision in 1882, they were often ignored. Part of the problem was that initially, electricity were local companies, who each supplied a particular voltage of electricity to their local area. So an iron used at home wouldn't be compatible with one in Liverpool.
It was down to the individual generating company what voltage that they put the electricity into the property. So even though you understood one system, it didn't mean that if you went further down the road and bought the electricity from somebody, it was the same.
On its own, like electrical electricity, when you bring in the human factor, that's when it's so dangerous.
There were countless stories in the varied ways people had managed unwittingly to electrocute themselves.
He accidentally touched the main and receiving the was killed on the spot.
The deceased, now laughing, swung himself upon an electric which broke, and the electric current passed through his body.
Being electrocuted, the effects of that depend on the duration of the electric current over the body. If you have a very low current for a sufficient duration, it can affect the beating of the heart. If you disturb that electrical flow around the heart, each of the individual contracts individually. And so there's no concerted effort, concerned no blood will be pumped around the body. So that is particularly dangerous. And that can happen if you take quite a low current. High current, you typically get a burn where the electricity enters and possibly reaches the body. And that is it causes the heart.
Those slow to address the dangers of electricity, all kinds of health-giving properties, which led to some strange practices.
Is that? I don't know. Some of these Sunday, later on the issue of babies, positioned in front of these.
YouTube always says that I have one viewer. Do I really have a viewer?
Where it was applied to a range of
a YouTube glitch. Because it always says I have a viewer.
And this is for massage. Ostensibly for massage, it was often used for more intimate sort of purposes as well, but it was just what they're saying. Right. Okay.
Things Edwardians got up to in their own homes revealed how little they understood this deadly force. Tomorrow, an extraordinary headline in the Daily Mail, a man accidentally electrocuted himself during his daily beautifying routine. He was using an electrical gadget which was plugged in at the mains and was designed to enhance and inflate his pet.
A man's fatal vanity. He attached the needle wire to the electric light, worked the needle up, and dropped dead.
Eventually, the audience were given the option of a wall socket instead of the light. At the time, both the plug and the socket contained metal, which created a small spark when they came into contact.
This spark is typical of many people's pregnancies, which means things plugged in or plugged out when you're put to block. So that's two pieces of metal coming in contact, they come out of contact, and they're locked up in the spark.
As most Edwardian homes were still using a lot of gas, which was prone to leaking, this small spark caused a big explosion.
Explosion just like that, the plumber, tying some of the gas. And there was a ghost, I feel, of the street. Leaking. The temperature would imagine.
Over time, improvements were applied that lessened the dangers.
It wasn't until 1999 that Edison came up with the idea of a rubber socket that went on for a boat and started fusing. And so I was really shocked when he was mentioning sleeping and the problems with sleeping. We see this problem of overheating.
But with its varying currents, assortment of sockets and plugs, no earth or fuse box, electricity was a dangerous business, especially as it was often installed and maintained by DIY enthusiasts.
Anyone could really wire up their home, so potentially people would not know what they're doing, getting into big trouble. Even one of Edison's early friends said, that's somebody who knew what he was doing.
By 1915, there were 600 suppliers across the country. The demands of war led the government to take steps to set up electricity, generation and supply of electricity more efficient.
And then the government actually made it. It all used the same current, voltage, it all come through the same way, and it was the start of the grid.
Despite all electricity became the utility of choice for the modern Edwardian. Most of the 1 million new middle class homes that we built in Britain had electricity wired in.
And Britain has some of the finest in the world. Today, most are decaying relics. Many of their now, historian Ruth Goodman, archaeologists Tom Pinfold and Peter Ginn are turning the clock back to relearn the secrets of their medieval castle. The origin of our castles is distinctly French, introduced to Britain at the time of 1066. In the region of France is Guédelon Castle, the world's biggest archaeological experiment. A 25-year project to build a castle from scratch, using the same tools, techniques, and materials.
It's a lot of hard work at Coalface, because this is industry.
For the next 6 months, Peter and Tom will experience the daily rigors of medieval construction,
Drop down.
Yeah. And everyday life. Our workers dressed.
Oh. Sorry, got to bring down the magnifier.
And the art of combat. This is the story of how to build a medieval castle. It's March. Ruth and Peter have traveled to Saint-Fargeau, 100 miles south of Paris, where Guédelon Castle is being built. They're now 17 years into a 25-year project, and over the next few months, its most defining features, the towers.
It's just something else. They're closing up there.
Oh, my goodness.
Aren't you dizzy?
We're meeting members of Guédelon's workforce. Master Mason, Friar Luke, and site administrator, Sarah Preston.
Thank you so much for coming so far. See our cast in the making. I'd like to introduce you first of all to Florian. Florian is our master throughout your stay here.
Can you oversee this entire project? That is amazing. That really is.
I know very well the castle.
But you're almost like the puppet master. You have the people working with masons, the carpenters. You've got to control everyone.
Well, I prefer the image of a musical conductor. But to be in the same time working, this is very important.
The rhythm.
So it's...
Well, if you're the conductor, you've got the strings over there, and the cushion over there, and the timpani over there.
Building Guédelon is an enormous. It will require some 30,000 tons of stone that must be quarried, shaped, and lifted into position. There are also teams of woodcutters and carpenters constructing scaffolding, roofing, and doors. Blacksmiths making ironwork and tools, as well as tile makers. In the 13th century, English workers crossed the Channel to hone their skills in France.
France is where architects, castles, churches, we're looking at their built environment and thinking, wow, they're really good at that. We're importing all those ideas.
Military historian, we're very used to reading the theories behind how castles are made, but hopefully it's an experimental archaeologist theories, put them into practice.
13th century life, there's a lot of questions surrounding it. There are. So by the actual act of building this castle, it's almost like creating a window through which we can observe what 13th century life has been like.
Building a medieval castle with a wooden model.
So what is this model used for?
In medieval times, you don't have a paper plan. They used to have a wood model.
I guess this is a way of the Lord saying, this is what I want my castle to look like.
Yes. He can change things with a model. It's very easy for him.
So I suppose... like you have here, you can easily have over 100 masons. They all can look at this and know the angles they need and the wall that they're working on.
Guédelon's design is typical of the 13th century. British castles such as Harlech, Conway, Carnarvon have a similar layout. Castles were not only for defence, but for strength, a lord putting his stamp on the landscape. Inside the walls, there were grand houses, kitchens, and even chapels. A thick wall surrounded by a dry moat protects an inner courtyard. Itself is protected by six towers.
Wow, this is the Great Tower. Is what...
When completed, the Great Tower will be almost 30 meters high, providing a lookout for approaching enemies. With walls 4 meters thick, it's the castle's ultimate stronghold.
So if we were the wall, I'd stand here. Side. That's four.
Right, that's massive.
It just brings tens of thousands of tons of stone will be in this castle when it's finished.
Back then, stone of a land was using horse-drawn carts. Minimizing the distance it had to be moved was paramount. Castles at the time, Gedalon is actually built in a quarry.
In the quarry, we have the sandstone, the primary building fabric. The sand and the water that can be used to make mortar. We have ochre, which again can be used for making pigments. We're on a clay lens here, used for firing tiles, roof tiles, floor tiles. And we're surrounded by forests, which is a source of timber, it's a source of fuel. Almost everything we need to build a castle is just a stone's throw away.
The boys are put to work extracting blocks of sandstone under the watchful eye of a stonemason who's worked here for 16 years.
The first job, the premier travail pour vous, c'est de faire des petits trous dans la pierre.
Make this.
Clement's teaching the boys how to cut huge stones from the quarry into usable building blocks. A chisel and a wedge.
I don't think I've got the skills to do this. I'll give it a go. This is all. Making this wedge snugly. But obviously, Clement, with his years and years of experience, knows exactly how to orientate this. So the wedge goes into the one hole, you hit it, and that's going to cause a fracture in the already pre existing sediment lines. Split in half.
C'est bon, c'est good. Oui, c'est bientôt fini. Bonne musique. Good music.
Good music.
And now I'm on that stage.
Wow, we can just see the fracture starting to appear. This is not about brute force, it's about listening, it's about looking, precision engineering.
Perfect. I see this is a good omen.
The hardness of the sandstone varies depending on the stone. So the medieval mason had a system of grading it.
The pith, the path, and the pith, this sort of black, high iron content sandstone, much used for the major low castle. The path, this more reddish sandstone, and the soft one, the puff, crumbly sandstone.
It's always like a shock of the stone, really, isn't it? We're coming out here, we're looking at the colours, and we can actually get what we want about to do.
These stones will form the main building blocks of the castle. Important as the stone were the workers. Surrounding the castle, Ruth setting up home.
Building a castle involves such a lot of people, and they've all got to live somewhere. So you community setting up at the edge of the building site, as all these different people come and go with their various skills. Begins to become a bit more permanent, a village in the making. Indeed, many villages right across Europe, as well as in France, can actually trace their origin to being camps for workers on a building site.
This small hovel is typical of a worker's home on a medieval building site.
Workers' cottages, somewhere like this, grown up in a hurry and fairly sort of basic. But then, so were those of most 13th century people. And this is our effort. Here is our kitchen, our living room, our sleeping quarters, just this one single space. Oh, look, marvellous.
The centrepiece of every medieval home was the fireplace.
Oh my goodness.
The fire was not just used for it provided heat and light.
In grand houses, obviously, they sort of like cobbled this whole area. We know from lots of archaeological digs that ordinary houses, it's just a patch on the ground. And also, bigger stones to balance what's some of it.
A cottage needs somewhere to store the staple foods of wheat and barley.
Oh, hello,
Ruth.
Hello. I'm good.
So Ruth is calling on English carpenter Simon Dunn to make.
I'm guessing that making furniture in the 13th century was rather different from what modern cabinet making would do.
Oh, certainly. Certainly very different. Or even in the last couple of hundred years. You're limited by the materials and the tools available.
In the 13th century, so carpenters used them only when absolutely necessary. Instead, wood was split using wooden wedges.
Whoa, wow, look at that. Split all the way around, don't you?
Yeah, and then turn it over. Work a little bit further down.
Gosh, this is faster than sawing, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. There we go. So that's in two.
Simon splits the wood again to produce planks.
So that's, you know, I mean, that piece particularly is a really blank.
Yeah, it's pretty flat. You can work with it.
And that's a couple of minutes. I mean, I hate to think how long that would take to
The rough planks must now be smoothed on.
This is a side axe. It's just ground on one, just flat on the other. So you can just trim up the surface a bit. You can more or less use an axe like a plane.
Made, the ark is assembled without nails or glue.
Pegs, your basic thing for joining.
Instead of nails.
Pegs instead of nails, yes. So there are some things you do need a saw for. So we'll just cut the pegs off to size.
Right.
There's no glue or anything in here.
So
it's just the wood holding the wood together.
Yeah.
So, are you happy with that then?
I'm happy with
that. Is that going to do the job?
It'll do the job.
Absolutely not.
Water was another vital resource for the building of a castle. And hundreds of gallons a day to make water alive. So, castles were always built near a plentiful supply. Have been sent to repair the castle's well. To hoist the bucket, it needs a new rope and pulley.
think you reckon? I reckon it was 10 metres down. Give or take.
But I suspect they sunk this to the depth where they're never going to... It's crucial to defence. It's crucial for life inside the castle once the castle's operational. You need to have that constant supply. And obviously we need it now for our building.
I'm not pulling it.
Peter's commissioning a pulley from Woodturn, Gary Baker.
Well, the first stage is to sweat a log.
Yeah.
And the pulley's going to be actually cut.
So you could just cut a nice section for a log and just do that as a pulley.
That would never work.
Really?
The problem with the end shrinks at different levels and it's just going to split apart.
Right.
So we're going to follow the grain this way. We're just going to rough.
What's the wood that you're using?
This is a very dry wood, and therefore when it dries, it doesn't move that much. It's not going to warp and crack.
Put it to the centre of the roughly shaped wood, so it can be turned on a pole lathe. Have been used both in England and France since before the 10th century.
So it's just a pedal, pulling a string.
A flexible pole. And a pole, basically, all it does is lift the pedal back.
The shaped ash is turned to make a cylinder.
Gymnasium.
As well as a pulley, they'll need a rope for the well. Rope is essential on a medieval building to lift loads and bind scaffolds. Tom's and the castle's workmaker, Yvon Elwar. First, he lays hemp yarns along the rope wall. Each with 14 yards.
I can definitely see why this is called a rope walk. Always in two. This 15-meter rope has actually walked half. It's extraordinary.
The four strands are now complete. Next, they must be twisted together.
First stage of the twist is to reduce the length of these strands by about 10%, so that's about 1.5 meters. So I'm estimating there.
When the traveler hits this mark, Yvonne knows the rope has been twisted the optimum number of times.
Very slowly, the traveler's moving in, but with each turn that Yvonne does, we get some icy.
Gary's turning the cylinder into a pulley. Groove in his ring.
Just take it off.
There we go.
It's so smooth and so fast.
Stop.
The yarns have been twisted to form strands. Are twisted in the opposite direction to form the finished rope.
To make the strands, you twist the yarns in one direction. To make the rope, you twist the strands against each other. You create that tension and that torsion, and it stops them unraveling.
Merci beaucoup.
I'll thread this through before you haul it off.
Now Ruth and Peter can fit the pulley in the castle's courtyard.
You know, traditionally, this is where people gossip, standing around the well. Well,
cooler. Drop it out.
Yeah.
One way down. On a medieval construction site, the majority of the water is used to make mortar to fix the quarried sandstone in place. Construction of the daily batch is supervised by Fabrice Mango.
Item, we need 25 baskets of this sand.
25.
Or this one.
Mortar makers had a vital role to play in the building of a castle, as the construction rested on their mixture. Formulas were closely guarded secrets and passed down from master.
Due to the huge amounts of sand required to build this castle, we try and source as much as possible from the local area. The quarry got it there, which got a huge amount of sand on tap.
Lime is the key ingredient that adheres to. It's made by heating limestone to 900 degrees and then mixing it with water to create slaked lime.
That looks very nice, Peter.
Well, my experience is showing for the French guys, they're really putting me to shame. It's, I do feel like now a bit more connected to the castle.
Clean, don't you? Honestly, Peter, some of us just get on and work. Like you, seem to roll around with every bit of building material that you can. Since you're
just that natural magnetism.
You can tell all that grey hair is actually mine,
Walter. Oh dear. Trust me, what do you want?
Today's batch of mortar and sandstone are destined for the Great Tower. It's reached a height of 18 meters, but when complete, it will be 30 meters high. The materials are using the treadmill winch. The forerunner of the modern crane, it takes two people to power it.
Well, these things are an absolute godsend, aren't they? They are the machine of the medieval building site.
We think we're 500 kg away from pulling up, and yet we maneuver it so easily, the two of us. Your ballast.
And look, there it is. This is the ultimate in medieval technology.
To lower the cargo onto the tower, the boys simply walk in the other direction.
Okay, so walk. Slowly, slowly. Yeah. So this is our stone, the sandstone from the quarry, and it will be graded into three lots and then the path above them. That's hard. That's path.
That's the medium.
Maybe a book in there somewhere.
That looks like us.
The pit, a very, very hard sandstone facing for the structure, for the external walls, whereas the pat and puff, that's used to infill the walls, tie it all together.
Philippe Delage began his career as a musician. For the last 10 years, he's worked at Guerlain, where he's perfected his skills as a stonemason.
But don't crush, just like this.
If you're a brickman, you do like
a flat surface, but stone and mortar has to go up into the stone. Yeah. So don't flatten it.
Okay.
One of the biggest challenges is ensuring the walls are actually.
The integrity of the entire tunnel depends on you. The solution is simplicity itself. A lead weight on the end of a plumb line.
On the scaffolding here, you'll notice there's about a 2-inch gap. There's a little plumb line down there to make sure the wall's absolutely. Tower starts going like that, it will start going like that.
Most of these medieval tools and techniques and are still used on building sites today.
Just doing the rubble infill to the wall. So we've got the facing stone, the pith, the hard stone, and that is laid horizontal runs as it is in the ground. Which, if you imagine a book, you lay a book horizontally. Weight, whereas if you lie a bit vertically and stand on it, it will collapse. However, the infill actually gets laid is going in the opposite direction, and that's because they're all stacked against each other and they push against each other around the tower. Absolutely solid. All the tricks of the trade.
Where's that mortar, Peter?
Already.
I'm hoping that the secret ingredient to transform what is frankly a muddy hole into somewhere comfy to live.
Medieval sources tell us cottage floors were strewn with rushes, but just how they were laid is a bit of a mystery.
My big answer is to keep it bundles and lay them in a sort of herringbone fashion across. Look, the temperature difference between putting your hand there and putting your hand there is that is cold and wet and nasty. That is warm and dry.
We'll lay down new bundles of rushes.
I think that when I get the fresh ones on top, what will happen is that underneath will, as these push down, will gradually compost, leaving you on top of you, well away from that, all dry and clean and warm. That's the theory. How this one looks. We'll see.
Back at the castle, slowly and surely in shape. But before they can build up the walls any further, a doorway into its third floor room must be installed.
This thing has been shaped by masons. It's going to go to the great tower for the doorway into that top room. We're just using this crane, Philippe.
Using this simple lever system, one man can lift four times his own weight.
It's okay.
The tower, using the treadmill crane.
I can see it coming up. Here it comes.
Oh, it's Disney's life.
It's all right, guys. Yeah. Bit of a swag.
Built castles, and this is the thing that made men feel quite seasick whilst on dry land, like myself.
Before the stones are fitted, a pinnacle is set into the stone, from which the door will be hung. It's held firmly in lead.
What they've done is they've built this reservoir out of clay, and that way you can pull the lead in and waste a valuable resource.
The masons have just one chance to get this right, as the lead sets almost instantly once it. Getting it wrong might mean the whole stone having to be replaced.
Well, that was brand new.
it's amazing to think here, a building of this size, how little metal is actually used. But where it is used, it is essential.
Now the stones can be set in place on a layer of mortar. It's essential that they're perfect. So the forerunner of the spirit level, the mason's level, is used.
Roman Britain, medieval France, or even like these are tools and techniques that every builder would have been familiar with. These have been honed over centuries of use. It is timeless.
It's good to know. Yeah. I'm gonna need a square here. Says it's all.
It's ready to for the next stone.
Now the stone lintel that will top the doorway can be.
This is very, very delicate. Well, this is an extremely heavy stone. And that's a serious bit of kit, and it struggles to lift it. It's so heavy. I think we're right on the weight limit.
Maneuvering this heavy stone with a simple crane is tricky. One slip, serious damage can and the surrounding stonework.
Yes,
well done. Stone masonry, like so many medieval jobs, is heavy work. Workforce was essential. To prepare food in the cottage, Ruth needs cooking vessels. And pans of metal, but in the Middle Ages they were often clay. Ruth is calling on the services of English potter Jim.
What would people think about cooking with pottery? I mean, I think people are scared of it, the idea of it now, but it's a way of cooking. I mean, it's the oldest form of cooking utensil of any sort.
Even your iron ones are called cooking pots. There's the clay.
First, Jim makes the basic cooking pot on the wheel. He then fits handles so it can be lifted on and off the fire.
The clay.
Stretching it out.
So it means that as you pull the handle, it creates the gravy.
Stronger than if it was just squished together.
Clay is heavy and difficult to transport. It from as near to home as possible.
Where'd you get your clay from?
From as close as
possible. The base.
Pots on the fire, big round bottoms.
Right, you want no sharp corners.
No, it means that the heat moves around the outside of the pot. And then with a sharp bladed knife, you start taking off the edge there. As long as the pots are made evenly, it will work better
right,
on
so
the
if there's
fire.
A big thick lump somewhere, that's then you're going to have problems around that.
The round bottom means it won't sit on a flat surface. So the medieval pot often had legs.
And there's the cook pot.
The hovel is now fully equipped and ready to sustain the workers.
This is perhaps the most important thing in it. This is our larder, our fridge, our pantry, our food supply, the grain ark. This is the mainstay of our diet. This is our main food. It's the starch, the bulk, and it's also a source of any beer or ale we might drink. And the lid is not attached because it goes that way up and it becomes my dough trough. And I need to make bread. And there are all sorts of food supplies hanging about, and hanging is the operative word. Because I don't want anything on the floor where mice and rats can get it. So hanging it either from the walls, like the vegetables in nets, or from the underside of the roof, keeps them safe away from all the crawling vermin. And the smoke, as it percolates its way out, keeps away flies. You can think of this space not just as a living space, but as a storage space.
After a day's work, the boys have returned to put Ruth's experimental rush floor to the test.
You've spent all day working on the castle, you're tired. Just come back. I mean, this is insulating. It's cushioning.
It's quite not as bad as you think. It's not as bad as you think, is it? I mean, when they say they haven't got a bed and that's it, you just got a blanket and this is what you sleep on. It sounds a bit horrendous, but it's not. It's all right. It is a tiny space, though, to live with. You have just one little space like this, is it?
Yeah.
As a whole family.
I'd much rather, well, I'm supposed to be in the I mean, I'd rather be in a small place like this and get the heat.
Yeah, it's the easiest place to live.
And also, how much time are you going to spend in here, really? Like, these days, you think, like, you know, sitting room with a TV and a big sofa, just going to relax in there. We're going to be working most of the time, and you've got all your jobs and tasks to do. So that sort of, like, rest and relaxation isn't as important. Jeez, cheers. Salute.
They don't clink, do they? That's about the only thing I've got against drinking bowls. They don't clink.
It's morning, and the team are getting ready for work. Knowing what ordinary medieval people wore is a challenge, but fortunately a few items of clothing have survived.
Most useful garments were survived because they were actively kept, because they were the clothes of saints. They have been preserved in churches right across Europe. So this yellow dress that I'm wearing, this is something that has been derived from two early to mid 13th century saints. Saint Elizabeth from Germany and Saint Clare from Assisi in Italy. So it's loose, but can you see, look, there is quite a lot of shaping to it. You can see all these seams. It's made very particularly to make the cloth hang nicely no matter what position your body's in. I have a belt. However, it's not to give you a waist, but it's all about creating an attractive drape of cloth. I'll tell you, it's the most comfy thing I've ever worn.
It is faintly ludicrous, I think, that medieval underwear is as big as this. I think, obviously, for Tomo, that's probably an appropriate size, but both myself and Ruth could fit into these. Oh, I feel a bit like a pair of 1950s football shorts, although in the light, vaguely see-through. And then we just got the hose, single-legged hose at this stage. But this is very similar to kind of, I suppose, stockings and suspenders. However, if they were sewn onto the pants, pretty soon you'd have a pair of trousers. You can't see where the evolution of clothes comes from.
Ruth's headwear is inspired by the medieval queen, Eleanor of Aquitaine.
And as she got older, she decided that her chin was sagging a bit, and she wasn't looking quite as lovely as she did. So she invented a barbette, which goes under the chin and onto the top of the head. And pain was there. And then, with a barbette, you always wear a fillet. And this is good, it's just another band sewn into a circle. And you wear that almost crown-like on top. It's a very 13th century look. So that's it. My French look.
Today, Tom and Peter have been summoned to the Mason's Lodge for the next stage of their apprenticeship, carving limestone. So far, they've been working with roughly hewn sandstone to build the castle walls. But for more intricate features like arches, windows, and stairs, limestone was preferred, as its fine grain meant it was quicker and easier to carve.
We need for the chapel tower a lot of stone having 10 inches.
First, the boys used their splitting skills to create rough limestone blocks under the supervision of stonemason Abdelilah Abid.
Now you can try the big one.
The rough block is moved into the Mason's Lodge onto a platform known as a banker, ready for the skilled job of shaping it.
How many?
10.
Yeah, really good.
Facing a stone was a basic skill that every stonemason would have heard. First, the edges are cut using a pitch.
Angle about that?
Yes.
Yeah. Actually, you have to do it in one time.
Yeah.
So you have to follow there. Yeah. Like follow through. Okay. Very good.
A stonemason would have learned under the watchful eye of the master mason.
I don't want to hear this. This is a word. Tech, 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 tech. The stonemason is heretical.
Yeah.
Or quick. Yeah. But it is always the same. You can do very rhythmical. You only change the rhythmical music, rhythmical, and a few minutes after you is finished. Okay?
Stonemasons were paid per stone carved. So the quicker they worked, the more money they would earn. These limestone blocks are for the chapel tower. This year, the team are hoping to build the walls up by 6 meters to complete the chapel room itself. In the 13th century, religion was central to daily life, and nearly all castles had a chapel.
Here we are. Well, we are in this room.
Yeah.
And we have to draw the niche in the east part of the room, just in front of us.
Yeah. This drawing you have is very much a kind of stylized view, but now as a stonemason, you must precisely mark it out.
Yes, exactly. We are now to transform an imagination dream in a youthful dream.
The niche is where the altar will be. Before any building is done, the walls must be marked out with absolute precision.
This is a continuing the curve of this wall.
The altar niche must be in the east of the tower. So Florian is marking out the east-west axis using an ingenious medieval tool.
I absolutely love this. It's a horn cut off the ends. That's been tied to a piece of string, which is wound around an axle end. It is encased in ochre powder. I mean, the same ochre that we find in the quarry. When you pull the string up and snap it, it hits the ground, thus shedding the ochre and leaving an absolutely true straight line. And these have been around for millennia.
Flip it over.
Using just a rope, dividers, and the ochre line, the chapel's walls are marked out. To reach this first floor chapel, a limestone spiral staircase is being built. To design it, Florian and Tom have come to the tracing floor next to the stonemason's lodge. The tracing floor was the nerve center of the medieval building site, where the master mason drew full-scale plans. Using a compass, the circumference of the spiral staircase is drawn, actual size.
This is an apprentice job. Always the apprentice, never the master.
Florian and Tom are working out the central part of our staircase, now forming a column that runs up, connecting all the stairs.
And now we're going to draw the 12th step.
For the medieval mason, geometry was the jewel in the crown of their art. Okay. Using just a compass, angles and shapes could be accurately drawn to within a degree with perfect symmetry. Here, Florian divides the circle into 6 equal segments, which are then subdivided to create 12 stones.
Now we have the step. We can try the step in the drawing.
I mean, this is a fantastic way to actually make sure, before you start cutting stone, wasting materials and time, that they work. You can see there, they're bigger than my foot then, so that's workable.
Now, we need to finish one step.
Because all the steps are the same, Fryer needs to make just one template.
This is a precision job now. You mess this up, you're going to mess up this stone in the castle.
So the last thing to do is basically just cut the template.
Thank you very much.
We've got our template now, placed on top of our large piece of stone. We're marking it out with a bit of slate. Magic. There it is. Now it's ready.
Just kidding.
Just cut it. 5-10 minutes.
Two or three days.
2 or 3 days. You can hear how good quality this stone is by the ringing sound of Kelvin Pitsley. I think that's why, to be honest, I'm standing here and not actually being allowed to do anything.
I like.
All right, then.
Apprenticeship for a stonemason would have been about 7 years. But to be honest, as Cameron says, it's actually a lifetime. You're always learning. And Pete and I haven't been here long. There's so much to take in.
Carving stone takes its toll on the tools. And every day they must be sharpened by blacksmith Martin Caudel.
Is it true, there's no blacksmith here for 2 days, work stops?
Yes, work stops, because we have to fix a lot of stone masonry tools. And if we don't know that, they can't work.
First, the worn down chisel is heated to 1000 degrees to soften its tip. To reach this temperature, bellows blow air through the fire.
I love these bellows. One goes up, the other one goes down. So it's constant airflow, isn't it?
Martin draws the chisel to a point on the anvil. Then sharpens it using a file. But the chisel tip will be blunt again in no time. Unless it's hardened. Hardening is one of the great discoveries of the ancient world, achieved by heating the metal, then quickly quenching it in water. As it gets hot, the metal changes color, and this tells the blacksmith how hard it will be once quenched. Too soft and it won't cut. Too hard and it will shatter. To carve stone, it must get yellow hot.
The watches for the colours appearing on the surface of the metal, blue, the red, and most importantly, the straw yellow at the very end. Now it's ready for the masons.
There are a few clues as to how ordinary people lived day to day in a medieval village. But Ruth pieced together fragments of knowledge to work out how people did the most mundane of everyday tasks, like washing up.
Haven't got a scouring pad, but I have got sand. For the pad, well, this time of year there's plenty of fresh grass. I could use straw just as something to rub with. Now, if I'm going to deal with grease, that's a different matter altogether. Sand will take the worst of it off, but, you know, I mean, no amount of scrubbing with just some more water is going to shift the grease out of something. You need a little bit of chemical help. And for that, I turn to wood ash, just straight out the fire.
The wood ash combines with water to make caustic soda. When it comes into contact with fat on the dishes, it makes soap, leaving the dishes spotlessly clean.
Handful of ash, wipe it around with a bit of grass or straw, rinse it out with hot water, and you get clean soap. Easy, easy.
Knowing what peasants ate in the 13th century is also a challenge. but we do know what ingredients they had to hand. Ruth has come to the castle's garden to see what there is to harvest.
I really do miss and see how fields patch a garden, but nonetheless, a fair few things are starting to sprout through, which is a relief. So, I've got parsley coming through here, and a number of other things that you might think of as weeds, and indeed they are weeds, but are edible. There's a lot of land cress, this is white flower on, so that's quite bitter in flavour, but you know, anything to give a bit of bite.
Plants that we now consider weeds would also have been used.
There's quite a lot of dandelions and nettles too, which will help bulk it out.
Wheat and barley were also essential ingredients. Flour was expensive, so workers ground their own, using a device that has been around for 10,000 years. The quern.
This is fast. A rotary quern like this is estimated to require about an hour to an hour and a half's work every day. This is the daily grind. Pop a handful of grain in the centre, barley in this case, and off you go. The posher you were, the more refined your food was, and ordinary people often they do. With food that was really quite coarse, and you can see that in people's teeth when we dug up archaeologically.
With the tools sharpened, Clement has put the finishing touches to the smith. Now comes the delicate task of transporting it to the chapel.
So your step's arriving. Well, I said your step.
The step is winched up the castle wall, using only manpower.
Ready.
So
break off.
Once on top of the wall, it's moved up the tower using an inclined plane. One slip and the step could fall, wasting 3 days' work.
What is it, Peter? Yeah. These guys have been doing this for 15 years. They know how to get things like this up here. But it's amazing what they can move without the use of what we call machines, essentially the use of rollers, levers, inclined planes, pulleys.
They're made out of wood.
Wood and stone working together, perfect harmony. Got me, someone.
Each step must be absolutely level, or else the staircase will veer to one side. A mason's level and plumb line are used to ensure it's perfectly positioned.
I suppose this staircase has still got quite a long way up to go, isn't it? And if this isn't absolutely perfect, the first little bit of skew, and that just gets magnified as you go up. But carrying anything up here, or, God forbid, fighting your way up here, it would be really difficult, wouldn't it?
Wedge. Using the greens from the garden and the ground barley, Ruth is cooking a medieval pottage in the clay pot.
So, a little bit of water in there. I'm going to start with the leeks. This time of year, nettles are still quite tender. I wouldn't say that you add nettles for flavour particularly, but they are quite good bulk. They're one of the few things that grows in profusion at this time of year.
Grain is added to create a porridge-like dish.
Right. how's it today?
It's going very, very well.
It's amazing how the whole thing is all in two-dimensional layers. And then you see, a third dimension appear, such as the doorway that you can work on, put the lintel on there, suddenly, wow.
It gives me a real feel, too, of just how much impact sort of places must have had on people. You know, if everybody's living in this sort of little tiny one-room, half in the centre, low building, and then there's that funking great thing up there, it's quite a shock to the system, really, isn't it? I mean, it makes a huge impact.
Well, this is a period when these great, like, military buildings, religious buildings, start to rise up and really make an impact on the landscape.
The team are also getting used to the simple medieval food.
This is a triumph. This is an absolute triumph.
For barley and vegetables, it's not bad.
You're a hungry man. You've been pounding all day at the stone, walking on the treadmill. Anything is good to eat.
It's not exactly easy either, grinding the darn stuff. I mean, it's just as hard work as pounding away all day at in the quarry.
There's no easy jobs in the medieval age.
No, there aren't, are there?
Next time, defending the castle with crossbones and architecture against the most powerful weapon of the age. The trebuchet. Dominated the medieval landscape, and Britain has some of the finest in the world. Today, most are decaying relics, many of their secrets buried in time. Now, historian Ruth Goodman and archaeologists Tom Pinfold and Peter Ginn are turning the clock back to relearn the secrets of the medieval castle builders.
This is the ultimate of medieval technology.
The origin of our castles is distinctly French, introduced to Britain at the time of the Norman Conquest of 1066. Here in the Burgundy region of France is Guédelon Castle, the world's biggest archaeological experiment. A 25-year project to build a castle from scratch, using the same tools, techniques, and materials available in the 13th century.
It's a lot of hard work at coalface, because this is industry.
For the next 6 months, Ruth, Peter, and Tom will experience the daily rigors of medieval construction.
Drop down.
And everyday life. How workers dressed and ate.
Smell food.
And the art of combat. This is the story of how to build a medieval castle. It's April. And since their arrival a month ago, the team have been learning ancient skills from the Guédelon masons. They've also set up a base for themselves in the shadow of the castle.
Building a castle involves such a lot of people, and they've all got to live somewhere.
The 13th century was part of the golden age of castle building, when ever-evolving tactics and fortifications were driven by the legacy of bloody crusades and vicious dynastic struggles. Medieval dynasties sought to expand their influence and protect their gains. They built imposing stone castles not only to assert power, but more fundamentally, to withstand attack. Now the team learn about building the castle's defensive structures. They look at the ingenious features medieval castle builders devised. And explore the craft behind the weapons they had to resist.
Defense for me really is the raison d'etre of the castle. It's not just, you know, the battles, attacking and defending, it's the structural input that you have to think about, your defensive, your curtain walls, your towers, things like that.
They are defensive structures, I suppose. I mean, they're much more than that, though, aren't they? I mean, they are about defending yourself psychologically. They're about telling everybody, don't even try it. And what about the weapons, too? I mean, what could they actually do against a castle? How effective were they?
I guess how many men do you need to defend a castle?
Okay, some ruddy, great big stores of food. And castles, you know, people sometimes get knights and princesses, but it isn't. It's mostly about the likes of us, isn't it? It's about everybody else. And how do we survive?
Yeah. A castle like this at Gedalong would have been built for a prosperous lord who wanted to display his wealth and power, and also needed his home to be strong enough to withstand potential attack. And this dictates much of its design, with 36 feet high curtain walls protecting the courtyard and residential spaces. Entry is via a twin-towered gatehouse. And at each corner above the crenellated walls, there will be four round towers, the highest of which will be the Great Tower, a superb vantage point, nearly 100 feet high. In charge of the defensive structure of the castle is Master Mason, Florio Renucci. He's traveled the world studying the ancient secrets behind medieval stonework. Gedalong's walls are over 12 feet thick in places. Today, the masons are placing a special long stone called a boutis into a section of castle wall, designed specifically to reinforce it against the town.
The wood is still to connect the front of the wall, front part, to the stone inside the wall. The wood is, for instance, you have one here. This stone here is very long, it's here.
Yeah.
We have to have a wall really strong. This wall have to resist an enemy, and the best way to fight a castle is to throw stone to the wall. If we don't put this, the front part of the wall will go down.
You can really see from this wall that you've got the external face, the internal face, and the middle, the infill.
That is well interpret when with this.
Can you help us?
Yeah, definitely. Very good.
It's in a strong piece.
I don't need to. That's the answer to this.
Yes, try to be always in the middle of the stone.
Yeah. Right.
It's a heavy stone to have a strong castle.
Booty stones are not just placed at random. They're fixed into the wall at 3 feet intervals to give maximum strength.
In the middle,
right,
of the dome.
So it's just linking in, but it's so clever because the pressure is now spread between two stones.
Yes, we have to think everything. It's like a game.
A medieval Tetris.
At Gedalong, they're using a medieval formula to make mortar, mixing water with quarry sand and lime putty. Unlike lime produced industrially, it will take many centuries to set completely.
We were afraid about it.
There's thousands of tons of stone being held together. There's a bit of a risk at the start.
Exactly. And it's the first time in Gedalong that we use this old way of making mortar.
Through experimentation, they've discovered that clay impurities in quarry sand give this mortar great strength.
So the experimental archaeology has actually given you a really good building substance to build your castle.
Exactly.
Torch has put the mortar down here, and he's making it rough. So when the stone goes down, that mortar would press into the cracks of the stone. If it was smooth, then you just have gaps. So if there's a bump in the stone and smooth mortar, it just wouldn't touch it. Whereas because he's making it all rough, it's squished together. And just keep that stone absolutely solidly fixed into place. So you can get Tom.
Every stone has to be aligned because this is an arrow up and up and up, potentially another 4 meters. These stones are slightly off, your build is slightly off, and eventually it'll collapse. And now the build will be solid.
Solid.
The biggest threat to castles were sieges. These were far more common than pitched battles and could last for months, even years. If they couldn't get through the gates, invaders could try going over the walls with towers and ladders, or mining under them. But another, more sophisticated means of attack developed. From basic stone throwers to mangonels, cuillard, and trebuchet, a range of deadly medieval war machines evolved. These came to dominate siege warfare for hundreds of years, until they were ultimately superseded by the cannon.
The largest ever trebuchet, it is thought, was that commissioned by Edward Longshanks, King of England, in the War of Scottish Independence, when he was trying to bring down Stirling Castle. It was a vast beast, called Warwolf, by the nickname. Disassembled, it took 30 wagons to move it. 5 master carpenters worked on it along with 49 other workers, and it could hurl an object of 300 pounds weight with accuracy.
30 miles from Guédelon is Saint-Brisson Castle, which houses a collection of replica siege engines. The Romans introduced basic catapults to Britain. But by the 13th century, the development of counterweight technology saw the introduction of deadly, high-powered stone-burning war machines. They were used in sieges to bombard defending troops and collapse castle walls. The crew wear protective helmets in case the machine malfunctions.
Think we can have counterweights. How's it going, Tom?
It's good, mate. It's amazing how only 4 people can maneuver such a heavy counterweight.
Yeah, I mean, what? That's about 500 kilograms. The energy you're putting into that to raise it up, it's going to be stored potential energy. And when it's released, this, which is about 10 kilograms, this ball is going to be swung out and flung into the distance. I reckon it'll go about 100 meters. Looking good. Right, you're just going to lock this off. There we go. Tension's on the pin. Now it's locked off, they can unwind this rope so that when it fires, or when it's loosed, the rope doesn't hold it back. Here we go, unwinding the rope. Whoa, watch those handles. And this is a well-trained crew, they know what they're doing. And this is, it's a very different, isn't it, from doing it in peace time, as it would be in the heat of battle.
So you hear that shouting, the noise. Yeah. These ropes can snap.
Here we go. The projectile into the sling, and it's ready to go.
So standing back. Standing back.
Just moving back. Going to this seclusion zone. I imagine if it was in the heat of battle, you'd just be there.
Yeah.
You'd feel quite lonely, you and the guy who's about to pull the rope.
Right. Countdown.
So, cut. What? Go! Delay!
still, look how much energy is still in there.
And you have to get the mathematics absolutely right. The difference between the length of that arm and the length of the rope. So if you don't get that spot on, it can fly backwards instead of flying forwards.
So if you deconstruct this, it's essentially scaffolding. It's a mason's shape.
It is.
It's the ropes.
And it's exactly the same mathematics that the masons are using. I mean, it's really, it's sort of simple, but it's also really quite sophisticated.
If you can build a castle, you can fight a castle.
That's the arms race that's happening in our period, isn't it? That the castles get more strong, more developed, more technical, and so the siege weapons become stronger, more powerful, more technical. Just keeps driving each other further and further on this.
It's not fast, though, is it?
Despite being slow, these mighty war machines were greatly feared in the Middle Ages. Some fortified towns surrendered at the very sight of them.
Why?
Should we go have a look?
Projectiles ranged from carved stone or mortar balls like these to rotting animal carcasses intended to spread disease and even the heads of defeated soldiers to really lower morale.
It's funny, isn't it, looking at the damage, you know, because it is just a small hole. So I suppose when you think against a stone wall, it's going to keep going until it finds a weakness,
this is
one
the hammer,
after another.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, the hammer doesn't crack.
It's not a great explosion, it's
the persistent drip, drip, drip until you crack.
As well as being an archaeologist, Tom is a midshipman in the Royal Naval Reserve with a special interest in military history. He's been looking into what kind of armor an ordinary soldier might have worn in the 12 Brothers. Not everyone could afford the expensive metal helmets and mail worn by wealthy lords and knights. A more basic form of protection commonly worn for combat was the gambeson, a padded linen tunic whose main protective element was sheep's wool. Tom's visiting Ruth in the hovel. She wants to make him a gambeson, and the process starts with the sheep's wool.
Ruth, when you asked me here for a fitting for my protective clothing, I was in chainmail and armour. That's not the case, is it?
It is, but it's not. This is cloth armour.
Cloth armour?
Yeah.
That's good, is it?
It is good. You're going to be glad of this, aren't you? So you have lots and lots and lots of layers of linen, and then a good fat layer of wool, prepared wool, and then more and more, more layers, many, and then you've got to stitch the whole lot together really tight. Not so it's like big and fluffy like a duvet.
Right.
Compacted right down into something truly dense.
Well, it's always, this is modern body armor, it's the evolution from this. It's still a balance between protection and maneuverability and trying to cover as much of the body as possible.
And this is the ancestor of Kevlar. It's a bulletproof vest.
Here it goes.
One of the defining visual features of medieval castles is their arrow loops. The ingenious design of these simple slits in the walls provided protection and gave castle archers a huge advantage. Gerlon Mason, Constantin Lemel, especially shaped the stone needed for building an arrow loop in a corner tower. before their mortar was thrown in place, they need to be sure it fits.
Right, so that's in position.
I thought that was going to go the other way around, actually. I thought.
We have to alternate. We have to have the long face here and after a short one. And when you have the short one, you have a long here and a short under. It's to get something very stronger when you cross the distance.
Yeah, okay.
The funnel-shaped design of the arrow loop, tapering to a mere 3-inch gap, gave attackers outside only a tiny slit to aim at, while the defenders could look out without being seen. The arrow loop sloped down, so archers could see invaders, even at the foot of the tower.
People can be in front of the tower, no problem for them, can't say.
I guess also this is a weak point of the castle, isn't it? You're actually creating a crack in your castle wall, so you need to reinforce it.
People said that in the 13th century, the long tower was very useful to resist when stone are falling on the tower. Because when the stones are coming, the round form used to be stronger.
Once you spread the pressure, then if the stone hits there and it's curved, then all these other stones take the impact.
Exactly. Well,
Peter and I are pretty firing arrows out. We just break our arrows on the inside. So
it'll be interesting to see if you fire an arrow or a bolt back in.
That's it. That's the trick, isn't it? If you're attacking, you want to be able to know, at least scare people, if not kill them, on the inside.
There'll be around 40 arrow loops in the finished castle. In order to test their effectiveness, Peter and Tom will need a suitable weapon. One of the most infamous at the time was the crossbow. First seen in 4th century BC China, by the 1200s, crossbows were increasingly used in European siege warfare.
Crossbows were probably introduced into Britain around the time of the Norman Conquest. In some ways, they were less effective than the longbows. They took an awful lot longer to load, so the rate of fire was much, much slower. Out in the battlefield, in the heat of the moment, they were pretty useless. But in a siege, it was a completely different thing. Behind some nice, safe walls, you had time. And it was the sort of weapon that anybody could use with no training and no skill at all. Richard the Lionheart eventually met his end when a crossbow bolt fired by a boy in 1199 pierced him in the shoulder. The resulting infection did for him.
As a weapon that made knights more vulnerable to lowly foot soldiers, some despised it for breaking the conventions of chivalry. But the art of crossbow making became a whole industry by the 13th century. In Britain, it survives to this day, among a few specialist craftsmen, like bowyer Chris Jury.
This is what's going to be known as a crossbow prod, which is basically the bow on a crossbow.
What kind of wood is this?
This is yew wood. Now, yew wood is probably the best wood for making a bow. In any piece of yew, you get the sapwood, and the heartwood. The sapwood is good in tension, which means it can stretch, and the heartwood is good in compression, which means it can crush. So the two grow naturally together in a single piece of wood to form a natural spring.
Chris uses a spoke shave to take off the bottom of it.